And welcome to Salam Shalom, Report on Palestine, Israel. I'm Mark Cage. This show is a production of Vermonters for Justice in Palestine. Please visit our website at vtjp.org. Tonight, our program will be devoted largely to a film by Harry Frears. It's called Gaza, Still Alive. Frears was in Gaza in 2014 when Israel launched a massive and devastating assault on the territory. He returned in 2019. His film documents the intensive and long-lasting impact on the mental and physical well-being of Gaza's people by having to endure now more than 10 years of a crippling and illegal blockade. Frears said of his film, quote, "I wanted to reapproach Gaza with questions that would refresh people's engagement with and compassion toward Gaza's people." And we'll close our program with a short video produced by Jewish Voice for Peace. It's part of a longer video project entitled Wrestling with Zionism. Thanks for being with us. Here now is Harry Frears, Gaza, Still Alive.
By all accounts, Gaza is a unique place. 2 million people live here. Most are refugees. Most rely on food handouts. Most are children or youths. And most bear psychological scars of war. It's the most impoverished Palestinian enclave besieged by Israel and Egypt for more than a decade. There have not been elections since 2006. Hamas still governs here. Palestinian factions can't agree on reconciliation. I witnessed the last war with Israel in 2014 and saw the utter devastation, mass loss of housing and life. But then Gaza left the headlines until more recently, ongoing protests along the border have highlighted Palestinians' desperation. 4 full years after the last war, and after 11 years under siege, how are people coping? How is mental health?
This film is not about Palestinian reconciliation politics or the politics of Israeli occupation, nor is it about rockets or bomb craters. Rather, it is about the scars and craters in people's minds.
Aya was victim to one of the most widely condemned episodes of the last war. Several UN-designated shelters were hit indirectly by fire from Israeli tank shells. Israel blamed Hamas for drawing fire toward Gaza's civilians.
كيف كان أقرب منا في المدرسة كان كنت نشوفها وصوتها كان.
9 family members were injured while seeking shelter. Aya, then 10 years old, was hit by shrapnel in her arm and both legs.
بتذكر كل إشي. بعد مرار بفكر بقعد هيك مع حالي بفكر. بتذكر أوقات الحرب بس رصيح لما بشوف إصابتي. هيك بحس إشي من جواتي بصير بزعل عليا يعني لما بطلع عصاتي أو لما بصرت أو لما صرت جوعني.
Back then, I reported on the psychological effects of living under heavy bombardment. In the impoverished and densely populated beach refugee camp, I interviewed Malak, who's now 12.
مثلا لما نيجي ننام نسكر اكيد الشبابيك والابواب بتيجي مثلا خبطه الشباك يا الباب الواحد بيلتمس وبخاف بنخاف عاد وبيلتمس وبعديها يعني خلاص بس بعرف انه خبطه الباب بس بضله تاثير مثلا للحرب معي زي هيك مثلا خبطه بردك هيك بنحس انه حرب.
The vast majority of Palestinian children in Gaza suffer post-traumatic stress symptoms. Emotional and cognitive effects include separation anxiety from relatives and what's called an exaggerated startle response. Behavioral effects include aggressiveness or withdrawal. Physical symptoms include bedwetting among children. Hassan Ziada is a lead psychologist at Gaza Community Mental Health Program.
We have programs for the kindergartens. We are working with teachers, we are working with the children, and some of the children, they are in need for advanced intervention. They are, can be referred to our community center. We have three community centers in Gaza Strip.
We will see the exhibition now for the drawing of the children. This picture is after the 2014 operation, and we asked the children, they brought some of their toys, broken toys,
right,
and they continue to have a picture.
What ages are the kids?
The ages, it's between 6 to 12 years old. And you can see one of the children chose this, and he tried to continue around the bloody issue. Yeah.
The average child over the age of 10, they have seen multiple traumatic incidents?
Yes. It's unexpected, uncontrollable, unavoidable. Yeah, it's actual threat for your life, for your integrity. So all of these things, it's a traumatic thing. And all the time you have the worry and you have fears that something will happen to you and to your family. And this is a toy that you can see, it's imbued. And the child tried to continue the leg, and you can see how it's a bloody face. Yeah. It's not easy for the children to talk about their fears, about their concerns, about their nightmares verbally. So sometimes we are using a drawing as an activity for the assessment and for the intervention to help the children to talk, to express what they are thinking about their intrusive memories, images, their dreams, their fears.
Israeli psychologists Jamal and Mohammed help bring some of the latest techniques to treat trauma to Gaza's clinics. They're with the Israeli group Physicians for Human Rights and have been joining medical delegations to Gaza for a decade.
الأوضاع النفسية في غزة هي مأساوية جدا. المعاناة واسعة والحياة من أسوأ إلى أسوأ.
الظروف اللي عايشينها في غزة كل أهل غزة هي ظروف صادمة. هي ظروف صادمة. ولا بد إنه كل الأشخاص اللي بيعيشوا هاي الظروف يكون عندهم بعض العوارض للصدمة النفسية حتى المختصين النفسيين مش أشخاص قليلين كل أهل غزة.
Trauma and grief are everywhere here, among children and among adults.
During the war also it was a terrible experience for me in the individual level. It was in 22 of July, I lost 6 immediate family members.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, 3 brothers, my mother, one of my nephew, and my sister-in-law. And that whole the family home was totally demolished. By that attack by the Israelis. So I personally was affected in that time. Yeah.
Aya still has shrapnel inside her leg. With time, it's moving, risking tissue and nerves. At its worst, the physical pain reminds her of the psychological scars.
بتأثر كتير يعني بزعل وهيك يعني بحس إشي من بزعل كتير يعني بقول طب ليش أنا بدل أعمل كل هالغلبة هذه كل يوم تجعني لما بأجي أمدها بتجعني بحس الشظية اللي داخلها بصير تنخص فيا في كل وقت ولما إصابته بصير تجعني برد بتذكر الحرب، بتذكر الوجع، بتذكر الحياة اللي عشناها أيام الحرب وأيام المدارس.
For so many here, the past is still very much present.
هل لقيتها أنا تغيرت من بعد الحرب؟
إيش أكيد آه طبعاً كنت في الحرب لما إجت الحرب خفتي صرت إيش صرت أي هواء أي صرخة أي إيش أي قصف أي إشي تلاقيك إيش تخافي ويا تصرخي يا تحكي يا ما الحقين 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 وهي إيه فيش إشي. طب هقيت لما كانت تشتي الدنيا في الوقت الحالي احنا لما كانت تشتي عندنا الدنيا كان صوت الرعد اول ما ترد الدنيا انت تخاف تقول هي اجت الحرب وهي خلقت رعد اجت خفيف رعد خفيف او مثلا تفريغ هواء تقول اجت الحرب كنت كل همك الحرب صرت بس ايش اي هواء اي حاجه اي شيء حرب حرب حرب.
Malak's school performance worsened after the war. It's all too common. Images of trauma and questions of life and death distract the mind. Two events shook Malak's world. The family was asleep, sheltering at her grandfather's house, when a neighboring home was destroyed by an airstrike. And then, a playground that was a reference point of her childhood world was also attacked.
طب هلقيتها لما مثلا قصفوا المرجيحة انت ايش كان موقفك من لما قصفوا المرجيحة كأنتو يعني بنات صغار كنتوا تمرجع المرجيحة وقصفوا المرجيحة ايش انت كنت اللي في بالك ايش كنت متوقع يصير؟
كنت خايفة كانوا اخواتي على المراجيح كنا مفكرين انه هذه المرجيحة ورحنا نشوف ماما قاعدة تحكينا وبابا روحوا جيبوا اخواتكم ورحنا النادي فيهم ويعني وعبرناهم كنا خايفين كثير انه حدا بقرب لنا يا صاحبنا الحمد لله يعني زي هيك ما طلعش كل ما اسمع اشي صرت اخاف وقلت ناس زي هيك.
اللي بيعيش القصف اللي كان موجود واحنا بنحكيش عن قصف طبيعي بنحكيش عن طياره مرقت وزتت قنبله بنحكي عن طيارات اللي تقصف اطنان من القنابل وتهدم عمارات كامله اللي بيعيش هذا الخوف في هذيك اللحظات بضل عنده خوف دائم وانت الحرب الجاي وانت الموت الجاي وانت الدماء الجاي وانت القصف الجاي وانت الدمار الجاي.
Hanging over Gaza like a dark cloud is the deep dread of more war. It's the morning meeting at the Gaza Mental Health Center. I'm sitting in to better understand the challenges faced in trying to help others keep things together.
So could you tell me about this?
في البشر أمام الصعاب أمام تحديين يعني يا إما بيقاوموا شغلات إيجابية يا إما بنهاروا إحنا مضطرين إن نبقى أحياء فعلشان هيك إحنا بنحاول قدر الإمكان وسط هذا الركام نحن يعني ندور على مصادر إيجابية تساعدنا يعني تقوينا يعني الحياة هي أساساً مفهوم نفسي الأشخاص بيناضلوا من أجله إحنا مش مضطرين نتعامل معها إحنا بنخلقها يعني أنت كمان وسط كل هاي الألام إحنا بنخلق إنسان فلسطيني عنده هدف رغم كل هذا يعني إحنا مضطرين نحب الحياة علشان نستمر في كثير ابداعات عند الشباب بيحاولوا انهم يثبتوا حالهم بمعنى انه اليوم احنا تحدينا كيف نخلق قيمه وسط العدم قيمه وسط انه ما فيش دعم كيف نعمل شبكه اجتماعيه مترابطه أمام التفكك الأسري والحياة الصعبة. اليوم العالم شئنا أم أبينا يعني يتآمر على إنسانيتنا. يعني إحنا زي اللي في صحراء ومضطر نعيش ودور على الماء، وإحنا فعلاً بندور على المية ومرات كثيرة بننجح يعني. فهذا التحدي إحنا يعني وصلنا له بمنظومة ثانية من القيم والأخلاقيات. إحنا والبيوت صرنا واحد، يعني حطام الحرب اللي هدم البيت هدم الإنسان. أوكي صحيح، بس في هان في تجديد مستمر في المقاومة. يعني الريزيستنس هذا إحنا بغض النظر مضطرين تكون عالية.
This resistance and steadfastness, psychologists call an adaptive belief system that strengthens people's psychological resilience. Greater resilience means better protection against trauma symptoms and, what's worse, debilitating trauma disorders.
بشكل عام مقاومة الشخص لأنه يطور مرض نفسي بتختلف من شخص لآخر. ممكن نفس الأشخاص يتعرضوا لنفس الصدمة النفسية بس حدا يطور أعراض صدمة وشخص تاني ما يطورش. هذا بيرجع لكذا عامل، إنه منها شخصيته، ثقافته، الدعم الاجتماعي المحيط فيه. في بعض الأشخاص ما بيكونش عندهم هذه الأمور، بالتالي بتكون مقاومتهم لأنهم يطوروا أعراض أو أمراض نفسية أقل من غيرهم.
Gaza has experienced 3 major wars in the last decade. Varying between each person is whether the repeat traumatic shocks build up or wear down an individual's resiliency. How well one copes is often interdependent on those around them.
أحد الآباء حدثني عندما كان يسمع صوت الطائرات الإسرائيلية كان يهيئ أبنائه ويخبرهم بأنه عما قليل سوف يكون هناك قصف. دعونا نكون موحدين ونكون قريبين الواحد من الآخر كي لا نشعر بالخوف وكي نواجه هذه الحالة حتى ننجو. وفعلا هذه الناس وهذه الأشخاص بحكم هذه المناعة النفسية تستطيع أن تواجه كل الأخطار وكل الصعوبات. في الجانب الآخر بعض الآباء كان يهرب قبل أطفاله وهذا كان يعود عليهم بالضرر، وبعض الأهالي لم يستطيعوا أن يهيئوا أبنائهم بأن هذا القصف سيأتي لاحقا بعد صوت الطائرة، فحتى اليوم هم مصدومين وكل ضرر وكل صوت يسمعونه هنا وهناك يجعلهم في دائرة الخطر والاضطراب.
حقيقة يا ملك تخافيش، ولو اجت حرب جديدة حتى كمان ما تخافيش. ليش؟ لأنه احنا كلنا في غزة متعرضين لأي حرب ولا أي هواية جايانا. في نفس الوقت يعني خلص إشي صار عادي عندنا طبيعي. عند الإجابة كمانها يعني فيش حد بخافش. أما مع الجماعة فيش حد بخاف.
Psychological research confirms Palestinians' remarkable coping ability. Mohammed did his thesis in 1995. His research found Palestinians' culture of resilience had helped children better cope with their trauma than Sicilian children traumatized by mafia violence.
في الحصانة النفسية كيف تتكون الحصانة النفسية؟ وفي غزة بيشتغلوا كتير، كل الجهات في غزة بتشتغل على قضية الحصانة النفسية عند الأطفال، مش بس عند الأطفال، عند الجميع.
السلام عليكم، how are you?
Ahmed was our driver during the war 4 summers ago.
Ahmed, how are you?
Alhamdulillah, tamam. عايشين.
During the war, Ahmed received a brief phone call while driving. He showed no reaction to the call until, after a few minutes, he told us his apartment building had been targeted in an airstrike.
His house was bombed just now.
Let's go there.
واحدة من عوارض الصدمة النفسية هي الفريز، فايت فلايت فريز. قضية الفريز، أنا أول ما أسمع الخبر أنا بتجمد بالضبط زي الأرنب اللي الصياد حامل البارود وبدي طخه.
After seeing the rubble and remains, Ahmed continued to work for the rest of the day.
إشي اسمه صمود، إشي اسمه مقاومة. اللي بيجي وكتير مرات بيعمل ستوب، بيعمل تجميد للمشاعر السيئة أو للصدمة النفسية اللي موجودة عند الأشخاص حتى عند الأطفال، لأنه الأطفال في قلب غزة كل الوقت بعلمهم إحنا شعب صمود، إحنا شعب مقاومة. شعب الصمود وشعب المقاومة ممنوع يكون مصدوم. فهي واحدة من الأشياء اللي بتمنع الأشخاص في إنهم يعبروا عن صدمتهم قدام الآخرين، أمام الآخرين. أنا لازم أكون قوي، لكن لما أكون في بيتي لحالي، لما أكون هناك، هناك الضعف تاعي ببين.
فإحنا لو كل ما يعني بيصير عندنا حدث بدنا نتوقف عن الحياة، فإحنا مش هنقدر نتقدم خطوة لقدام. فإحنا عادي يعني ممكن ينخصف بيتنا، وممكن يصير عندنا حدث كبير وعادي نكمل حياتنا. إحنا هيك يعني تأقلمنا مع هيك حياة. هو شوفي، لأنه أنا يعني عملت 3 حروب كسائق، فخلال هاي الفترة شفت حاجات كتير يعني كتير كتير فوق ما تتصوري. شفت شغلات، شفت ناس كتير مقطعة، ناس ميتة. فوصلت لمرحلة صار عندي نوع من لا مبالاة، فصار عندي هيك نوع من البرود يعني من كتر يعني ما شفت. فهل الآن يعني خلص وصلت لمرحلة عندي نوع من لا مبالاة، فلهيك أنا خلص صرت مرتاح يعني متأقلم مع الوضع كيف ما كان. أنا متأقلم معه سواء سيء أو منيح، أنا متأقلم معه.
قضية الفريز هي إشي، هي ردة فعل طبيعية، وكثير من الأشخاص التلبد المشاعر، تجمد تاع المشاعر، هي ردة فعل كثير طبيعية ومنشوفها عند كثير أشخاص. شوف قديش موجود أولاد في المدارس اللي هن فقدوا أعزاء لإلهم قدامهم خلال الحروب، عم بيكملوا حياتهم. وهذا هو الفريز الدائم، وهي وسيلة دفاعية اللي في كثير مرات لابد منها في وضع زي غزة. إيش بدي يساوي؟ إيش بدي يساوي؟ يعني غير إنه يقاوم نفسه، يقاوم الألم تاعه ويعيشه ويضل ويخلي ويكبته في داخله ويكمل حياته، لأنه منحكي عن ألم اللي مش من السهل أي بني آدم يتحمله.
طبعاً البيت اللي انقصف لحتى الآن ما انبناش تاني، لجنة الإعمار يعني ما لسه ما انتهتش من إعمار البيت. هو بيتنا كان 6 طوابق ولسه هما في الطابق الأول. أنا طبعاً شقتي كانت على الطابق الثالث، لسه ما وصلوهاش.
Almost 20,000 homes were hit in 2014. The Gaza Strip is just 140 square miles. No neighborhood was spared the effects of the last war. Israel's targeting of the homes of Palestinian militants was controversial both politically and militarily. But the psychologists here have their own professional take on the tactic.
There is a lot of family massacres. And they, because they knew that one of the main protective factors in our community is the family. It's one of the more strongest survival mechanism for our community. Because of that, if you can talking about how many mosques was demolished, how many schools, how many organizations were demolished during the last war, because they are knowing, because they have a question, why is still this people? They have this resiliency and they still have the motivation to struggle for their basic rights. So they try to broke these protective and strong aspects in our community. So you have to not to deal with any national activities as a Palestinians, because you will be punished. You will be punished, yes. If you will have, you are living in a building that somebody, according to their perspective, as a suspected, as a resistance one, that all the building will be demolished. If somebody is a family member, all the family will be killed.
I'm putting that to the Israel Defense Forces, that the military tactics hurt the civilian population at large more than Hamas. I got no response. But previously, Israel has said this.
During the 2014 Gaza conflict, the IDF took various steps to mitigate the risk of harm to the civilian population. Unfortunately, some of these attacks resulted in damage to residential buildings, mostly when these sites became lawful military targets due to Hamas's use of such sites for military purposes. The short and long-term psychological effects of attacks from the Gaza Strip on Israel's civilian population have been devastating.
But Israel's army is not unaware of the pressure cooker of stress in Gaza. It's ironic that within Israel, army chiefs are often the first to raise the alarm on crises among Palestinians. Their pulse on people's desperation informs their war preparations. Israeli government critics say the current leadership is occupied by a zero-sum game mentality, that any Palestinian weakness is Israel's strength.
במזרח התיכון, בחלקים רבים של העולם, יש אמת פשוטה. אין מקום לחלשים. החלשים קורסים, נטבחים, נמחקים מן ההיסטוריה. והחזקים, לטוב או לרע, הם אלה ששורדים.
There hasn't been a war in Gaza for almost 5 years, but the soundscape of war still plays out here, and not just in people's minds.
الذين هم في صلاتهم خاشعون. صوت الزنان بأثر عليه كتير. يعني بنزعج منه كتير. بعرفش أقرأ منه وخلاص يعني عشان إحنا تعودنا عليه كتير بس يعني بصير راسي يجعني لما أسمع كتير. صوت الزنانة لما بسمع صوت الزنانة بشعر بالحرب.
Aya lives in the north near the fence with Israel. Drones fly overhead, buzzing every second of every day. At school, kids and teachers regularly talk about a potential imminent war.
الحرب مستمرة في غزة. الحرب ليست فقط قنابل وصواريخ وقتل. الحرب النفسية مستمرة. الحرب الاجتماعية. الضرر الذي نتج عن الحرب مستمر. الناس لا تشعر بالأمان. عندما لا يشعر الإنسان بالأمان، فإنه يشعر طوال الوقت بأن هناك حرب، حرب آتية. في أحد الأيام سألت امرأة كم جيل ابنك؟ أجابتني في الحرب القادمة سيكون 6 سنوات.
هي للأسف إنه المشكلة إحنا بنواجهها إنه إشي إحنا بنسميه اللي هو أونغونغ تروما. إحنا خلال يعني مشاهدتي أنا الأطفال اللي بيجوا عندي بتحسنوا وبكون أمورهم كويسة بعدين بصير خصوصا الأطفال اللي عايشين في المناطق الشمال أو اللي على الحدود إنه لو سمعوا طيارات لو سمعوا أشياء لها علاقة في الأمر السياسي بترجع عندهم الأعراض مرة تانية. هذه مشكلتنا بشكل عام في غزة، أو إنه لو صار أي توتر أو أي حدث الكل بصير يحكي، السواقين، الناس في الشارع، الأهالي في المدرسة إنه في حرب جاية في إشي، فبالتالي الأولاد بخافوا وبترجع لهم ممكن الأعراض مرة تانية.
PTSD تمام؟ والبي تي اس دي انتم اخذتوه يعني كجزء من الكريتيريا تبعت الانكزايتي ديس اوردرز في التشخيص بنفرق بين الاكيوت ستريس والبي تي اس دي.
The Gaza Community Mental Health Program offers a qualification in community mental health.
زي النساوة بنسى الحدث الصادم والدي بيرسوناليزيشن والدي ريلايزيشن.
تمام. كيف ممكن نقول الحدث هذا تروماتيك مش تروماتيك؟ صادم
انكسبكتد.
صادم انكسبكتد.
There is energy here, and the will to resist suffering by helping others. These are tomorrow's psychotherapists. But the human resources currently available mean it's only possible to tackle the toughest, most chronic cases. That means mental health care in Gaza is but a drop of supply in an ocean of demand.
وكل بيت وفي كل بيت هنالك مأزوم أو مضطرب أو من يعاني اضطرابات نفسية.
في غزة بحاجة مش لمؤسستين وثلاث مؤسسات وأربع مؤسسات، بحاجة لمئات الاختصاصيين النفسيين المختصين بعلاج الصدمة النفسية. إحنا بحاجة لكمية هائلة من الاختصاصيين.
في الواقع كون أن الحياة في غزة صعبة جداً، الناس تريد أن تأكل في البداية، والعلاج النفسي يأتي في الدرجة الثانية. فكم بالحري عندما نتحدث عن حالات القلق، التوتر، الخوف، التأتأة، النمو، الصحة النفسية، الصحة العقلية، لا يوجد لهذه الاضطرابات لا يوجد مكان ولا يجهل. الناس لا تهتم بهذه الأمور، وهذا ما يقلقني وهذا ما يخيفني.
Israel and Egypt, Gaza's two neighbors, impose a tight blockade on the strip. Generally, people can't leave here, and what goods enter are controlled. Israel says it imposed the siege after Hamas took control of Gaza in 2007. The UN says this has prohibited collective punishment of a civilian population. Economists warn the economy here is on the brink of collapse, that the strip is a step away from de-developing. Even hospitals face chronic shortages of key supplies and medicines.
Welcome. Thank you so much. How have you been?
I'm fine, thank you. I can't say I'm good, but still alive.
What is the collective mood at the moment here in Gaza?
To live under siege for 11 years without electricity, without clean water, all the borders closed, no one can go out, no one can find the essential things to live in. This makes you feel that you are in a prison. We are really live in a big prison. So this actually is very bad, and make the people very frustrated and without hope, actually. There is no light at the end of the tunnel.
Feeling like you're living in a prison creates its own kind of ongoing trauma. The World Health Organization says long-term feelings of frustration, lack of opportunity, and crushed dreams are indirect consequences of the Israeli occupation. Almost half the workforce has no means to earn a living. Youth unemployment is at a crushing 60%.
الشاب اللي فيش عنده شغل شو بده يسوي؟ بصحى من النوم متأخر، بيعيش في حالة يأس كثير كبيرة، وفيش أمل، فيش أمل عن جد، ما فيش أمل إنه هذا الوضع يتغير.
Our old driver Ahmed still works 14 hours a day, but his brother is not so lucky.
إن شاء الله بتتوظف قريب. أنت خلصت شغلك في كمال عدوان؟
خلصت.
طب ليش ما جددوا الكاش؟
حاولت أجدد أنا، قالوا له بنفعش لازم عشان تشوف غيرك، يعني عشان تعرف خريجين كتير، 160 تقريبا 160 ألف خريج، فبدهم يدي فرصة لغير يعني، فتمشي الدور يعني.
ألف صحة هنا شباب. الله يسلمك، شكرا. إحنا جينا اللي انظلم عن جد والله.
انظلم، ما شافش فرصته في حياته.
وراحت علينا، إحنا قلت ما ينفعش للوظائف، ما خدوناش.
And you can imagine that you are a father and you have the skills and you have the motivation to work. Do you want to fulfill the basic needs of your family and you cannot find a job? And you can see the feeling of despair and the anger that will be expressed to whom? Verbally or physically, to whom? To your wife, to your children, or to yourself? If it will be to yourself, toward yourself, that means you are in the path to reach depression. So if you want to express it toward your wife and your children, that means your violence, domestic violence increased, and this is the impression from our practice that the level of domestic violence became more than before.
Divorce rates have been worsening too. And it's a taboo to say, but there have even been reports of women prostituting themselves. All the indications are that Palestinians are reaching a breaking point. 2 years ago, a UN official warned Gaza had already passed the threshold as an unlivable place.
غزة سجن كبير لا يوجد أمل في الأفق الأمراض في تفشي وازدياد الأمراض الجسدية الأمراض النفسية.
The people here in Gaza they start to have manifestations of for their suffering. People they express their psychological problems through physical complaints, somatic complaints. You are talking about headache, back pain, abdominal pain. You are talking about high blood pressure. You are talking about diabetes. You are talking about heart problems and disease.
الضغط النفسي المستمر يصيب المناعة الجسدية وهذا بالتالي يؤدي إلى الأمراض وهذه الأمراض في ازدياد.
But some of the people they are going to the general practitioners and the primary health care centers and they are some of them are misdiagnosed. And they have prescribed some medication, and they try to alleviate the psychological pain. And there is no any organic cause for that. And some of them they will misuse these drugs, and this a way that is culturally accepted because we still have some stigma. It's a very sensitive issue that you have a mental problems and a mental disorders, and you are not so courageous to go. To the mental health services and to ask for these services. So sometimes that you can express the suffering through your body.
You have children, right? Yes. How are they doing?
And have two young children, one in high school, and the youngest is in the sixth grade.
How does he deal with the situation?
Actually, every day they tell me, whenever the border is opened, we don't want to live here. We want to go anywhere else.
How do you feel about that?
Very sad, very sad. I never imagined that we reached this point. I never imagined that my children waiting the moment to leave our home. So imagine this, that people who, although financially they are comfortable, other people who are not comfortable, of course they more eager to leave this country. So this make me feel very sad actually. That my country became in a miserable situation that no one wants to live in.
Like so many young people, Aya also believes life would be better on the outside.
لأنه أأمن وهنا يعني برا ممكن أتعالج. هنا فيش علاج يعني قال لي بنفتح 15 سنتي من اللحم عمل السمنصل يعني صعب كتير قال لي ده بعملها ليكي عمسئلتك انت يمكن تنشل رجلك فعشان هيك يعني كلهم خايفين الدكاترة وقال لي يعني حاول يعني تسافر برا أحسن من هنا ويعني بتمنى اني أسافر أطلع برا عشان أتعالج وأطيب أطلع من هذه المشكلة من هذه النفسية.
But even with injuries requiring treatment abroad, the idea of being granted freedom to leave is more distant illusion than workable plan. Some people's desperation to escape Gaza has been so great that they've tried to smuggle themselves on small boats bound for Europe. Ahmed was seriously considering joining one attempt.
وفي الباخرة كنا بدي أطلع أنا في الباخرة اللي طلعت في الحرب منيح ما طلعت الباخرة اللي غرقت
بس خطر يا عم
في شاب والله صاحبي من دار الجروشة طلع فيها
لليوم الله يعين أبوه، ما أعرفش في أي وين بلاده، ما أعرفش إذا ميت ولا عايش.
ما هو أغلبهم بيغرق في البحر لأنه
ولا حدا أساساً فيهم بين.
والله أنا ما بعرفش ناس معينين بالضبط، بس اللي بسمع بالأخبار يعني كتير ناس فقدوا في البحر لأنه في قراصنة أنت تعرف.
أنا كنت أطلع فيها بس إنه انقصف بيتي في ذاك الوقت فما طلعتش. الله طلعنا ما طلعنا فيها.
With war and siege from the outside, with overcrowding and poverty around, Gaza offers the perfect storm in a cage for people's mental health. But the numbness and depression start inside, internally, in people's own minds.
It's a global issue that will affect every aspect in your life. By electricity, by lack of the water, by pollution, by lack of medical services, it's not allowed for you to travel. It's everything. You are unemployed. That means every aspect of your life is affected. It means not the specific. It's a global effects, and it's also stable. That situation will continue, and it will be more worse and worse. And that means if you are talking about it's internal, it's a global, it's stable, that means you are induced state of land helplessness, and it's a plan, and it's they are using the maximum punishment toward the people here in Gaza. It's the same mechanism it's used with the torture survivors in the prisons. Yeah, it's the same. Yeah, when you are talking about torturing, put the prisoner in a state of total helplessness and he cannot do anything.
إسرائيل تستعمل أهل غزة يعني مصطلح فعلا كحيوانات في قلب مختبر، حابسينهن في قلب هذا الجيتو من 10 سنوات، يتحكموا في كمية الأكل اللي بتفوت، يتحكموا في كمية ونوعية الأدوية اللي بتفوت، يتحكموا في الأشخاص اللي بفوتوا وبطلعوا من غزة، يتحكموا في كل مجرى الحياة في قلب غزة.
The psychologists say the siege serves to weaken the Palestinians' mental resolve. Cut off from the outside world, there's also a collective sense of total abandonment. The United States recently withdrew funding for the UN Refugee Agency here that supports half the population with food aid. Trump now promises the deal of the century to settle the decades-long conflict. The fear is this too is about squeezing Palestinians before imposing a settlement on them.
وهي تجربة جديدة كمان بفوت على غزة. هل إذا بنقطع المعونات تاعت الأنوروا رح يكملوا في رح يكم يظلوا عايشين ولا رح يموتوا؟
We are following and what is going in the news and how we are talking about the deal of the century and how the Palestinian leadership will be under pressure and they have to accept what will be offered without any objection. And so it's like putting you in the position you have to accept what will be offered if it also will be against your struggle for your basic rights as a people.
It's hard to tell whether Dr. Abu Shaban looks more strained back when I interviewed him at the height of the 50-day war, or more strained now. Because, like during the last war, the ongoing psychosocial war on Gaza delivers its own supply of casualties to the Burns Clinic.
Now you're seeing more suicide attempts every month.
That's right, that's right. In the past, suicidal attempts was very rare, but it increased dramatically, actually, in the last few years. It's at least 2 to 3 cases every month. But this make me raise my voice to all the leaders in this country and around the world that this is a warning thing. It's a very bad thing. Gives impression that people are reaching a very difficult point, and explosion is not far from now.
Raising their voices is what thousands of Palestinians have been doing since last March. Israel, which calls the protests riots, has come under global condemnation. More than 250 Palestinians have been killed, mostly by sniper fire, sometimes after throwing stones, other times for simply protesting too close to the military fortified fence. But this new normal of violent suppression is not deterring ongoing protests.
Because I see many people, as I said, result of this situation, suicidal cases, people burned due to electricity cut, they use candles, they use primitive stoves. Actually, these things should not happen, actually. If you imagine living with electricity for only 4 hours a day and 20 hours without electricity, how can, if you imagine yourself in your country live, this is very difficult, very difficult. This reflects on everything. So just we asked to live as a human beings. Leave politics for people to speak about politics, but we have to live as a human beings. This is the simple rights, to live as a human being, not to live under siege, not to live without electricity, not to live without clean water. We don't have clean water to have because everything depends on electricity. Even the sewage system depends on electricity.
For many, especially the poorest families, Gaza's beaches were one of the last places they could go to feel some freedom. But now, many tell their children to stay out of the water because even the polluted sea is really no longer safe. For many here, to be still alive in Gaza is to have no real freedom, no real life. And that's why so many continue to put themselves at actual risk of really losing their lives.
It means a lot for the Palestinian in the psychological level. To be engaged in the struggle for your basic rights as a people, it's a psychological thing that we will keep our self-esteem and self-respect as a Palestinian, because it's an issue that we are fighting for these basic rights. But if the Palestinians will not be engaged in the struggle to end the occupation, that means it will be the moral defeat for the Palestinians, and they will lose their self-respect and their self-esteem. Because of that, still the Palestinians, they can have a high level of tolerance, they have resiliency, because what we are believing and the meaning we are giving for our suffering.
وبفكر إنه مع كل المآسي أنا بعتبر غزة لإلي بوصلة للصمود للثبات مع كل الألام اللي بشوفها هناك مع كل الألام اللي موجودة بتعمل لي ألم وبتعمل لي أمل في نفس الوقت أهل غزة هن أشخاص يفوقون المتوقع الطبيعي تاع الإنسان بقدرتهن على البقاء بقدرتهن على الصمود وبقدرتهن على الاستمرار
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم قد أفلح المؤمنين الذين هم في صلاتهم خاشعون
There is transgenerational trauma here, but there's transgenerational resilience too. those spared by war have been left behind to survive with the pain and to endure long-haul battles against trauma and despair. Many never begin recovery. The protest suppression has become another cause of ongoing trauma. When there's electricity, the bloody scenes play out on local TV. They don't have to be witnessed firsthand to affect people in this environment of pervasive insecurity. In one school surveyed, 6 in 10 children reported having frequent nightmares.
إذا كانت النفسيات مدمرة ومهمشة، هذا يترك آثار كبيرة مستقبلاً. يعني فرضاً لو بنيت دولة في الغد وكانت هنالك فلسطين، سيأخذ أجيال كثيرة حتى يخرج هؤلاء الشباب والأولاد من المآسي النفسية. النفسيات المحطمة وهي محطمة إلى حد بعيد.
في كل مرة أنا أدخل إلى غزة أشوفها في حالة أسوأ. اليأس، الإحباط، مع كل المقاومة والصمود تاعهن، لكن اليأس والإحباط حاضرات بشكل كثير كبير. هناك بتمسك الألم في إيديك، بتعيشه، تقرأه على وجوه الناس، تقرأه من كلماتهن، من نغمات صوتهن، حتى لما يكونوا يضحكوا وحيويين وهيك، لكن تقرأ في الخلفية ألم مخيف.
It's not just homes not being rebuilt, it's people's mental health too. I witnessed the last two wars here. Since the most recent in 2014, people haven't been able to get their lives back together as they could after the war in 2012. Coming back now, I've been shocked to see old faces still shell-shocked. Most people I've met here look like they've been deprived of daylight or free life itself. How are people here still alive, but a sense of suffocation permeates daily life? Post-traumatic stress disorder has been described as an engine that perpetuates conflict. You relive and re-experience trauma through repeating flashbacks and nightmares. But in Gaza, the trauma is continuous and cumulative. In the eyes of the psychologists, if Gaza were a single person, you'd say it's been trapped in solitary confinement for more than a decade. But Gaza is 2 million people, each with their own feelings, hopes, and dreams. If Gaza has a population of 2 million, it needs 1 million trauma experts.
في تصوري أنا غزة قد تحتاج إلى 50 عام قادمة لتخرج من هذه المأساة. حتى لو فرجت وكان هنالك حل في الغد للقضية الفلسطينية ولغزة، التأثيرات النفسية الموجودة تحتاج إلى جيل أو جيلين، إلى 40 أو 50 عام حتى ينتهي هذا الصراع النفسي عند الأشخاص، حتى تعود الناس إلى نفسياتها. غزة تسير في بداية الأمر نحو المجهول، لا أحد يعرف ماذا سيحدث في غزة.
Growing up in Israel in the 1990s, there was never any particular moment when I started being a Zionist, just like there was no moment when I started being a Jew. being a Zionist to an Israeli Jew simply means being a good citizen.
My father was 8 years old in 1948. The family lived in Ramallah, city of central Palestine. My family were thriving farmers. We lived in a peace, Muslim, Jewish, Christian, celebrated each other holidays and worked together. After the Balfour Declaration, everything changed. Palestine was partitioned, and although the Zionists got almost 60% of the land, they wanted more. They occupied the city of Lod, and many Palestinians were killed. My family went from being farmers owners to being refugees in camps, to being homeless and stateless. My dad just started to share his stories because after 69 years, his wounds started to bleed. He has nightmares when he screams and wakes up horrified.
My ongoing struggles with Zionism have been defined by the fact that it was Zionism in the first place that radicalized me. It was in Zionist education that I learned to develop a critique of society and to think about how race, class, and gender contribute to privilege and inequity in my daily life. I'm not proud of how long it took me to reach my current convictions about Zionism. And yet, I cannot regret the attachment to Israeli society that my education afforded me.
I was born in Romania during World War II. I grew up in Tel Aviv and spent years in a kibbutz. As a liberal Zionist, I prided myself on my progressive values. I was against wars, racism, and discrimination. I did not know how much I didn't know. The population in Israel-Palestine is divided about half and half. Jews and Palestinians. Yet, I did not have one Palestinian friend, acquaintance, or neighbor. The Palestinians are on the dark side of the moon. Do you know that in Jerusalem city maps, Palestinian neighborhoods are blank, as if they don't exist? It has been hard work to examine my own mind. My solid identity has been shaken and then broken.
I am a Palestinian American whose family has lived in the West Bank for over 400 years. I also have family in Jerusalem. In Jerusalem, Israeli soldiers are everywhere. When they see my Palestinian name, they treat me like a criminal. They pat me down and check my bags. It's stop and frisk, Brownsville, Brooklyn style, every single day for Palestinians. I remember seeing a group of Israeli soldiers going up to a young Palestinian man and slapping him around and calling him names. He looked scared and confused. His hands went up to shield his face. My instinct was to protect him, so I walked toward the Israeli soldiers. One of the soldiers came up to me, put a gun to my head, and said, "Do you want to die?" I would show my face in this video, but I fear for my safety. We've been threatened because we're Palestinian and because we're Muslim.
My father was born in Hebron, Palestine. He always identified as a Palestinian Jew. He was very Jewish and very anti-Zionist. People are generally surprised by this, but there are a lot more of us than you think.
I wanted to learn. I wanted to see.